Choosing the right SCADA component feels complicated, but the wrong choice doesn't just cause headaches. It can cost you thousands in hidden fees and downtime. After 35 years in the field, here is my complete guide to getting it right every single time. Hey everyone, Alana here, and today we're starting with the unsung heroes of wide area monitoring, RTUs, remote terminal units. Not all RTUs are created equal. You've got three main categories, and knowing which one to use is crucial. First, compact RTUs, typically 8 to 32 I/O points, perfect for small pump stations, tank farms, or remote monitoring points. They're cost-effective but limited on expansion. Modular RTUs are my go-to for most applications. They start small, but can grow with your needs. I've seen installations that started with 16 points and expanded to over 200 without changing the base unit. Then you have high-end RTUs for major substations and control centers. These handle thousands of points, multiple communication protocols, and advanced functions like sequence of events recording. Here's what separates good RTUs from great ones, and what you need to look for. Power reliability is everything. Look for wide input voltage ranges, built-in surge protection, and battery backup capability. I've seen RTUs survive direct lightning strikes because they had proper power conditioning. Communication redundancy is non-negotiable. Ethernet, serial, radio, cellular, the more options, the better. And here's a pro tip. Always spec dual communication paths for critical sites. When that fiber gets cut by a backhoe, you'll thank me. Operating temperature range tells you everything about RTU quality. Cheap units spec 0 to 60 degrees C. Industrial grade RTUs handle minus 40 to plus 85 degrees C. Trust me, that extra temperature range isn't marketing, it's reliability. Here's my field-tested RTU selection process. First question, how many I/O points do you need today, and what's your 5-year growth plan? Always add 50% to your current count. You'll use it sooner than you think. Second, what's your communication infrastructure? If you're running fiber, Ethernet RTUs give you speed and bandwidth. Cellular areas? Make sure your RTU supports the local carrier frequencies. Rural radio systems? You need RTUs with built-in radio modems. Third, total cost of ownership. That cheap RTU might save money up front, but factor in maintenance visits, replacement parts availability, and technical support quality. I've seen $1,000 RTUs cost more over 10 years than $5,000 units because of these hidden costs. Now let's dive deep into PLCs, programmable logic controllers. These are your precision control devices, and understanding their capabilities can make or break your automation project. PLCs come in three main categories, and picking the wrong one is like bringing a screwdriver to do a wrench's job. Micro PLCs, typically under 32 I/O points, fixed configuration. Perfect for simple machines, small pumps, or basic automation. They're cost-effective, but limited on expansion and processing power. Next, compact PLCs. These hit the sweet spot for most applications. They have modular I/O, multiple communication options, and sufficient processing power for complex control. I use these for 70% of my installations. Finally, modular PLCs are for the big leagues, complex processes, high-speed applications, extensive I/O requirements. Think chemical plants, automotive assembly lines, power generation. You'll also hear these called process automation controllers, or PACs. Same concept, different marketing term. Here are the specs that really matter, not the marketing fluff, but the numbers that determine if your PLC can handle your application. First, scan time is everything in control applications. If your process needs millisecond response times, you need a PLC that can deliver. I've seen projects fail because someone picked a PLC with 50 millisecond scan time for a 10 millisecond application. Second, memory capacity isn't just about program size. It's about data handling, recipe storage, and historical buffers. Always spec at least double the memory you think you need. When that process engineer asks for more data logging 6 months later, you'll be ready. Third, I/O specifications can make or break your design. Analog input resolution, update rates, isolation levels, these aren't just numbers on a data sheet. They determine measurement accuracy and system noise immunity. Here's something they don't teach in automation school. The programming environment and long-term support matter as much as the hardware. Stick with established programming platforms. That obscure PLC with great specs might look attractive, but when you need support at 2 a.m. on a Sunday, you'll want a vendor with 24/7 technical support and a large user base. Plan for obsolescence from day one. Keep spare I/O modules, document everything, and maintain programming software backups. I've seen million-dollar systems shut down because nobody could find the programming cable for a discontinued PLC. Now that we've covered traditional RTUs and PLCs, here's something that's changed dramatically since I started in this business. The line between these devices is getting blurred, and you need to understand this evolution. Traditional RTUs were data collectors and communicators. Traditional PLCs were local controllers. But modern devices? Many can do both jobs equally well. Today's so-called RTUs often include sophisticated local control capabilities, PID loops, and millisecond response times. Modern PLCs come with advanced communication features, multiple protocol support, and wide area networking capabilities that were RTU-only features just a few years ago. So how do you choose in this new landscape? Focus on application requirements, not device categories. First, what's your primary function? If you're mainly collecting and forwarding data from distributed points, configure as an RTU. If you're performing time-critical local control logic, configure as a PLC. Many modern devices can do both simultaneously. Second, communication requirements. Do you need multiple protocols, wide area networking, or cellular communications? Modern devices handle all of this, whether they're called RTUs or PLCs. Third, environmental requirements and reliability. This is where traditional differences still matter. Devices marketed as RTUs typically still have better environmental specs and longer mean time between failures because that's their heritage. Fourth, total cost of ownership remains critical. That versatile device might cost more upfront, but could eliminate the need for separate RTUs and PLCs in your system. All right, let's move on to human-machine interfaces. HMIs are where the rubber meets the road. A good HMI makes operators efficient and reduces errors. A bad one creates confusion and downtime. HMI hardware has evolved dramatically. Understanding your options helps you pick the right tool for each application. Industrial panel PCs offer maximum flexibility and processing power. They're perfect for complex applications, but require more maintenance and have higher failure rates than dedicated HMI terminals. Dedicated HMI terminals are purpose-built for industrial environments. They're more reliable than PCs, but less flexible. For most applications, they're my preferred choice. HMI software design is where most projects succeed or fail. Here are the principles I've learned from watching operators struggle with poorly designed interfaces. Navigation should be intuitive. Operators shouldn't need training to find basic functions. Use consistent layouts, logical grouping, and clear labeling. If you need a manual to navigate your HMI, you've failed. Alarm management is critical. Too many alarms and operators ignore them all. Too few and problems go unnoticed. Use alarm priorities, group related alarms, and provide clear acknowledgement procedures. Trending and historical data help operators understand process behavior, but don't overwhelm them with information. Show what they need when they need it, and make detailed data easily accessible. HMI performance affects operator efficiency and safety. Slow updates, sluggish response, or system crashes can lead to poor decisions and accidents. Network design affects HMI performance. Overloaded networks cause slow updates and timeouts. Design your network with adequate bandwidth and proper segmentation. Now let's talk about SCADA servers. They are the supervisor of your operation. They coordinate everything, process data, manage alarms, and provide the platform for your HMIs. getting this wrong affects everything downstream. Single points of failure are system killers. SCADA servers must be redundant, and that redundancy must be properly designed and tested. Hot standby configurations provide the fastest failover times. The backup server runs continuously, synchronized with the primary. When the primary fails, switchover happens in seconds, not minutes. SCADA servers are communication managers. They speak multiple languages and coordinate conversations between devices. Communication performance affects everything. Polling rates, timeout settings, and retry parameters must be properly configured for each device type and communication medium. Now let's talk about data historians. They are often treated as afterthoughts, but they're crucial for optimization, troubleshooting, and regulatory compliance. Choose wisely because you'll live with this decision for years. Historian sizing used to be a major headache, but with today's massive hard drives, storage capacity isn't the problem it once was. Still, you need to consider your data retention requirements and growth projections. RAID. One mirroring is the minimum I recommend for historians. When a drive fails, and they will fail, you need that data protected. I've seen companies lose years of historical data because they skimped on drive redundancy. Good historians use intelligent compression algorithms that reduce storage requirements without losing important information. Look for exception-based logging and swinging door compression. Historical data is irreplaceable. Once lost, it's gone forever. We talked about RAID protecting against drive failures, but that's just the first layer. You also need proper backup procedures for disasters like fire, theft, or data corruption. Test your restore processes regularly and consider off-site storage for critical data. RAID keeps you running when a drive fails, but backups save you when everything else goes wrong. Sometimes you still need dedicated communication gateways and protocol converters that go above and beyond what's built into your SCADA software. These are the unsung heroes of integration. They let old equipment talk to new systems and bridge protocol gaps that would otherwise require expensive upgrades. So what have 3 decades taught me? The magic isn't in any single component. It's in how they all work together. Integration is where projects succeed or fail. Here's how RTU-PLC overlap affects your system design. You can now use fewer device types to accomplish the same goals. One hybrid device might replace both a traditional RTU and PLC in remote locations, simplifying your spare parts inventory and technician training. But don't get carried away with overlap. Sometimes purpose-built devices still make sense. A dedicated historian will always outperform a hybrid device trying to do data logging as a side job. Match the device to the primary application requirement. I've seen the same mistakes repeated for decades. Mixing too many protocols, inadequate network bandwidth, poor grounding practices, insufficient documentation, and no backup plan or disaster recovery redundancy top the list. I cannot stress this enough. Proper system commissioning and testing procedures are absolutely critical. I've seen many chintzy commissioning and testing procedures that lead to serious problems down the road. Test everything twice, document it once. Proper commissioning procedures catch integration problems before they become operational nightmares. So there you have it, a field guide to SCADA components. Remember these key points: RTUs for remote monitoring with emphasis on environmental ruggedness, PLCs for fast local control with appropriate scan times, HMIs designed for operator efficiency, redundant SCADA servers for reliability, historians for data preservation, and gateways for integration flexibility. The most important lesson? Think system-wide, not component level. Every piece affects every other piece. Understand how your choices today impact your operations tomorrow. If this helped you understand SCADA components better, hit that thumbs up and subscribe for more practical industrial controls content. Drop a comment telling me which component gives you the most trouble. Thanks for spending time with me today, and remember, understanding your components inside and out isn't just technical knowledge, it's job security.